Volker Grimm, who's from the Helmholtz Center for Environmental Research based in Leipzig. And Volker is going to be talking about a clear guide to communication modeling, not models.
Yeah, good morning. I'm not a mathematician. I was a little bit nervous when I was invited to speak here. I was afraid that people would expect that I would show some proofs or theories and solve some integrals, but I'm happy I came. My background is biology, and I also studied physics, so I don't flinch when I hear about integrals. But I'm working as a professor of theoretical ecology, so I'm working with ecological models. So, theoretical indicators, typically I just don't speak to the public, I publish papers. But 10 years ago, I was leading a large European project where we were dealing with the registration of pesticides. So, that's the context where all this happened here. So, I speak about models and how they are communicated to regulators. Yeah, so, and then I will speak about risk assessment of pesticides. On the next slide, I will explain what that means. And, ecological models, they go from very simple mathematical models to really very complex individual-based or agent-based models. And I'm more on the simulation side. I will speak about trace documents and free screening questions in this field approach. So if you are a company and you want to register in your pesticide, you have to go through a very elaborate procedure. You have to perform all kinds of tests, and it takes really a lot of effort, a lot of money. And the dossiers which you submit them to the authorities are thousands of pages. It's really a major effort. And in Europe, European Union, the EFSA is responsible for writing this guidance document. In the UK, it's the health and safety executive. And the overall rationale is that you have to show that your pesticide, according to the test, is falling below the so-called risk quotient threshold. So what is affecting the risk for populations of non-target or disease spray? Something in the field, it is designed to kill animals, but it should not overly put non-target species at risk, like earthworms, pollinators, moles, whatever. Right, and so what is affecting this risk? It is the exposure, of course, how much are these individuals exposed to certain pesticides and the toxicity. Yeah, and if you relate them to each other, if you have very high toxicity, you should have very low exposure. If you have very high exposure, you should have very low toxicity. Toxicity is still the denominator because it's measured by a certain critical dose. LD stands for lethal dose. Highly toxic means already very low dose is killing the animal. So if you can show, according to all your lab tests and so on, that your product, your compound, is below the risk quotient, it can be registered, it can be used, it's considered safe for the population. Now, of course, toxicity is measured in the laboratory as individuals under controlled conditions. Whereas in the field, well, there are all kinds of compounding factors. So, what does a laboratory test really mean in the field? Nobody knows. So, it is practice that people then apply safety factors. Yeah, so the first year, the first test which the pesticide should pass is then multiplied by thousands. And it has made much, much harder to pass this threshold. So uncertainty here is taken into account by applying the safety factor. It's common practice, it's used in Europe, it's used in North America. Now, if your compound does not pass this test, this happens sometimes, you have to go to the next year. You have to perform some, let's say, greenhouse experiments or mesocosm experiments. So you have a higher level of realism, and then your safety factor is reduced, for example, to 100. If you still do not pass the threshold, then you have to go to the field, you have to do really almost natural conditions field experiments, very expensive. And then you maybe have the safety factor of 10. You should also take into account that these safety factors vary according to the organisms you're talking about. So these safety factors are much, much higher for person members than, for example, for earthworms. So the field approach is approaching from lab to field experiment as well as traffic. It is working to some degree. But of course, these uncertainty factors, these safety factors, are totally out of the blue sky, right? So what do they really mean? This is typical, like, some rule, well, let's take 1,000, maybe 500, maybe that's what happens. And it may well be that sometimes these safety factors are too protective, so you still have a lot of uses that you specified or underprotected. Nobody really knows. And that's why people 10, 15 years ago thought, why don't we use ecological models? So we take this toxicity measure from the lab, we take this estimate of exposure, we put it into an ecological model, for example, of honeybees, and then we run the model, and then we use the model to have a more realistic estimate of the risk. Is it really safe with these numbers? Is the resilience, is the persistence of the population impaired or not? Right? And so there's high potential there, but now you have a problem, you have a model like me, like us, and we try to do a good job, we use all existing data we have, all existing expert knowledge we have, we put it into a model, and then we present the results to the regulator. And the regulators usually don't have any training, any knowledge of modeling, how does it work, how to assess it, it's pretty hard for them. And typically, the first question they ask is, show me that the model works. And then our response is, it's a little bit more complicated like that. So I understand the position, the skepticism of the decision makers. It's a healthy attitude. You shouldn't immediately trust the model. Models are synthesized representations to answer specific questions. So by definition, they leave out many factors, and they present many other factors in a much simplified way, right? So why should I, as a decision maker, base any decision on the real world, affecting the real world, on the output of the simplest but possibly inappropriate representation? So that's a healthy attitude. So what questions should the decision maker really ask? Well, they should know more about what actually is the model. No, not just the black box. What's in the model? What's not in the model? Why has it been designed this way? Is it because you like integrals, or is it because you like computers, or because you have always done it like this way, or is there any more real rational behind it? Has it been correctly implemented on the computer? Maybe all the sensory results are there because you missed the semicolon something, right? Has it been thoroughly analyzed? We as models always say, don't ever trust the output of a model like a black box. Make sure that you understand how these results of the models were emerging. So are the main effects well understood? Then, of course, the questions of authenticity and uncertainty. Yeah, you have a certain risk assessment. How certain is it, and how sensitive is it to uncertainty and parameters in model structure? And of course, this question was, so did that the model work? So, what is the evidence that the model is realistic enough for its intended purpose? So, there's a whole range of questions. It's a pretty long list, kind of scary. So, how can decision maker answer all these questions? When reading these thousands of pages in the dossier, they have no training, have no time, and they have no clear idea usually how to assess this model and the analysis and predictions. So what's the counterfeit? Well, just reject model-based risk assessment, that's still practice in Europe, it is okay. This is from country to country a little bit, but people are still very, very skeptical, and I understand that. There are other sectors in environmental science where models are used a lot for decision-making. They're often the attitude is just accept the model-based risk assessment because everybody did it for 20 years. Yeah, so there are good examples in this book, research analytics. There are many, many cases in environmental sciences where models are used, although it's known for 20 years that they are just wrong and inappropriate. Because everybody is using it, it's part of the regulatory framework. They don't risk trying to do anything new. So these are two extreme attitudes, so what can we do about it? And so our point in this European project was that the problem is that models are based as static entities. Yeah? You hear something about the model, you hear the main results, but 90-95% of what good models really do remains undocumented. So this so-called good modeling practice, so doing a good job at various levels, we try to do it, but it's documented nowhere. So how could then anybody access the value of what we are doing? We need a standard way of documenting and also then at some point planning model development and testing to get a trace of what we have been doing before we came to the end result of being reported and documented. And so we called it the trace documented the standard format for organizing the document using elements of model evaluation. Evaluation is an artificial word combining evaluation and validation. It doesn't matter in this context here. It's a means to an end. It's documenting to what degree and how good modeling practice was followed. Evaluation is defined as the entire process of establishing model quality and credibility throughout all stages of model development and application. So it's really trying to, it was published 9 years ago, and if you have this kind of document, if you have produced it, then in your main paper, your main report, you should refer to it in this way. There is this supplementary material, that trace document. It contains evidence that our model was thoughtfully designed, correctly implemented, thoroughly tested, well understood, and appropriately used for its intended purpose. So that people, if they have doubts, if they have questions about various parts of the model and how it was developed, all these questions that I listed a few minutes ago, that they can find easily this information because it's presented in a standardized way. So this is the structure of the trace document. It contains sections referring to the different typical steps of model development. So what's the problem? Problem formulation, yeah? So what's your specific question? What's the overall purpose of the model? Then, of course, describing the model itself. It can be just a set of two equations. It can be 20, 30 pages, very detailed description of the simulation model, right? There, again, we have developed another standard framework that I won't talk about this year. It's called ODD, apparently. What kind of data? Number three, what kind of data went into the calibration and parameterization of your model? What kind of expert knowledge went into it? Really be very clear about this. Then the conceptual model evaluation. You have an overall design of the model. For example, you might decide that in my model, the typical time step is a month. Why didn't you choose a week or a day or a year? So what's the rationale behind it? Or my model ignores spatial relationships. It can make sense under certain conditions. And so you should explain why you did so, right? Well, my model is deterministic because I think variation doesn't matter. My model is set up, things like that. Then, of course, implementation verification. Did you really test the code? Can you document these tests? Can you really show that the model is actually doing what the model is supposed to say, right? So this is very important. Then model output verification, you try to make sure that the model is reproducing certain observations. Yeah, you're getting the average abundance of the population right, you get the age structure right, you get the spatial distribution right, things like that. And this usually involves calibration and of course you test various sub-models until you get to this point. Model analysis, this includes also sensitivity analysis, uncertainty analysis, and also understanding the main effects. And then last but not least, model output corroboration. People would usually call this validation, right? But the term validation has been given so many different meanings, it's impossible to narrow it down to anything, so we call it like that. Validation differs from verification in our interpretation that the model is making predictions of observations that you have not put into the model, so independent predictions, right? So Einstein's gravity waves were a consequence of his equations. Yeah? He did not design the model to reproduce gravity waves. They were a consequence. And sometimes we can do the same in a topological model. Not often, but sometimes we could do it. And that's, of course, then really a very strong argument that the model is capturing the essence of the organization and the manners of your population, for example, right? And so the template is organized in a way that always starts with this in this smaller font with a description of the section so that the writer and the readers are really fully aware what the section is about. And then, very important, we ask people then to have an executive summary. This is so to say, in a nutshell, what kind of information is provided in this section. This is to say, the project is really for the public, whereas all the other parts are very, can sometimes be very technically detailed. And if this section is very long, for example, in the model description or in the model analysis, we should have also a little table of contents. And so we have these template elements for all the 7 elements. And it has been published 9 years ago. It has not been used massively, but I think there's something like 30, 50 examples now in the published literature. It is being used now in pesticide assessment. People like it. So the template works quite well. It's kind of a common language. You know exactly where to put what kind of information. We even published a paper 2 years ago about modeling notebooks. That while you do work on the model, you make notes already using this terminology, yeah, so that you can, at the end, use information from the notebook that you use the trace recognition. It can be very long, sometimes more than 100 pages. But the main point is that readers know where to find what kind of information, so the trace really provides supporting evidence and increases the model's credibility, or as you said in this earlier talk, in this slide, so that people, it's really what good modeling practice. People did a good job, and it's all transparent and all documented. But of course, trace is for those who in principle have to evaluate the model. So the people sitting in the office at these regulatory authorities, they got all these questions and they have to think about it. What about those who have to make decisions but who are not expected to go into detail? What if you're from the media, you want to communicate what the model has been done, or if you're a politician or a manager? Right, so the recent example is lot of models effective that use from COVID. So how to speak about them, how to communicate, how to compare them? Because sometimes the predictions are really not comparable. So our approach was trace includes the answers. It includes the answers about the uncertainty and how much data went into it. It includes the answers about the verification, the corroboration, about the background of the rationale, and so on. But what are the right questions to ask? And of course, this paper then was triggered by the COVID pandemic. It's much more general now than this discussion of pesticide. I think this question catalog can be applied to any type of model. As you confess that we started writing with the 10 questions, and it didn't work. And then seven is the magic number. People would like it here. But this politician will ask 7 questions. There's no way that it'll ever be hesitation. And actually, it's possible to find around the 3 questions. It's a very funny phenomenon. Never, ever anybody would try 2 questions or 4 questions. Do you know why? I don't know why, but it's like this. But really, seriously, it's questions about the purpose, the organization, and the evidence. It's really summarizing everything from what I said earlier. So the purpose is really, there are all kinds of model purposes. I'm not talking about the specific research question. I'm talking about really the overall purpose. Is it to demonstrate a certain concept, like density dependence, or flatten the curve with a certain concept? Or is it about understanding, like a scientist, I want to understand how certain things are happening, I want to have a mechanistic understanding, or is it really about prediction? And these are different model purposes, right? And the most common mistake we see in the application of models that people mix these purposes. A model which was designed for understanding is used for prediction. A model designed for demonstration is used for understanding, right? So that's very, very important. Then, of course, organization, what is in the model, what kind of variables is it using, what kind of spatial, what spatial scale and extent does it use, the same for the temporal scale. What kind of processes are in the model, right? If you have a COVID-19 model and you don't really have transportation in the model, yeah, that's an assumption, you should justify it. If there's another model, which really has a transportation network, the interaction network of the people, it's a different kind of model. So you should know about it, right? And then, of course, very important, the evidence. So is there evidence that the model works? So what kinds of observation does it really reproduce? And we have had another type of modeling strategy called pattern-oriented modeling, so people criteria establishment. So if you have a model which is able to reproduce a whole set of observations at the same time, it's probably more realistic than a model which is just fitted to one observation, things like that. And of course, the case of independent predictions, which they're not put into the model from the very beginning. And so, to be able to answer these questions, you should have this comprehensive documentation, which I mentioned earlier, phrase and the ODD protocol. And so, these three screening questions support decision makers. And so, I think it's simple enough. Of course, you still might need some other person who's looking at all this information, but at least it's there. Yeah, so, let me end this with a little joke. You all know this, so all models are wrong. a summer youth role. I think he was the statistician. And yeah, that's why. But this misses the key points in model communication. I think the key challenge is all models look right. But how do we know? Right, so create a culture of asking the right questions about models and establishing standards so that at some point people expect that you follow these standards is one way, I think a very good way of doing this. And then, of course, communicate the answers and the documentation before these questions are asked. So it's really up to us modelers to provide this information. So the summary is the field approach starts on screening questions, create sensitivity towards purpose, model assumptions, and evidence for realism. It's all down to just really very simple three questions, and then you can go into detail if you want those things into. Make sure the answers can easily be found in case documents or similar documentations. And then, of course, you can compare and assess different models addressing the same question or system in a more systematic way. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Volker. So again, any questions for anybody before we get to the break? I'm probably trying to bring just another one. We're starting to do
That was super interesting and it speaks to my soul. Something that I found really challenging about communicating models to the policy audience is from politics research about some use of evidence in policy making, which covers some work that I've done. And one of the things that came out of it was that the policy makers liked the models they understood less, because that meant they must be really clever. And as someone who sat down with some of the people that were literally interviewed for that study and tried to explain some of the models to them, profoundly depressing. But I just wondered whether you think, like, was that a failing on my part because it didn't explain it well? Or should we just write some people off that they will never get it? Or is there something else that we can do to get through
this? So yes to all your alternatives, but of course, there have been many publications about this issue of communicating models, even complex models, but in my experience, it was not politicians in this case, but against authorities in Germany, wildlife diseases, controlling them, and a colleague of mine for 10 years tried to convince them, and they didn't. And then there was still rabies in Germany, and there was rabies was almost eradicated, and then they had to plan for emergency. What if we have still one case? What can we do? And then they wanted to adopt a strategy which was successful for measles, kind of a ring vaccination, right? So that's the kind of what to do. And then my colleague looked at it and said, it's not going to work for rabies because the foxes, they move in a different way. So he implemented their model, he implemented his model, because clearly showed that what they had intended was very, very risky. They were convinced by that, and then he was very lucky they implemented it. It happened a year later, and it worked perfectly as it predicted. I would say he was wrong. But the point is, sometimes it's very good to say, make these decision makers aware that they are using models all the time, right? And to make those models explicit and then start from there. About the complex model, what you said at the beginning, I'm not so sure about that.
Thanks very much. Very quick question, if
you can. David Knorr, University Press. As a publisher, I often come across work that is based on models, should we say, and eventually the distance between the work and the model becomes very big, and people tend to believe the model rather than the actuality. Now, you're never going to get over that, but I wonder, can you add robustness, or maybe you did and I missed it, to one of your elements? Because obviously, if the model is very sensitive to changes, then maybe it's not such a good model for basing other research or working.
Yeah, I completely agree. So, this is what we call a robustness analysis, which is kind of an extension of sensitivity analysis. It's really part of this space document, absolutely. But one point is really, people say, what does the model say? That's the wrong question. What do you say based on what you learn from the model?
Thank you very much. So I suggest we break now for teas and coffees, and if people can get back to you in time by 11:50, that would be associated. And if you've got any other questions, then just a reminder, there will be a round Q&A session on. But if we could just thank the speakers for this morning, that would be really great.